And now, Samba. What else when it's titled Povo de Brasil, a tribute to the ingenious people of the Amazon. Ladies and gentlemen, a big hand for Brazilian singer Vera Americo. Vera Americo.
Samba começou na areia, festa na aldeia de Tupinambá. Quando a lua fez brilhar na estrada, Deus Tupã clareia, deixa clarear. Quando o samba começou na areia, festa na aldeia de Tupinambá, fez brilhar a luz da lua cheia. Deus Tupã clareia, deixa clarear. Jurunas, carapis, caiacangues, caiapis, terenas, carajás e curuís. Terenas, caxambés, achavantes, afoxés, terenas, carajás e suruís. São povos do Brasil, donos desse chão, herança cultural do nosso sangue. Eu sou tupiniquim, sou caiacó, sou curumim, tupinambá e anomami. Deus Tupã clareia, deixa clarear. Quando o samba começou na areia, festa na aldeia de Tupinambá, fez brilhar a luz da lua cheia. Deus Tupã clareia, deixa clarear.
Today's children are tomorrow's grown-ups. I'd read something for you which made an impression on me a long time ago. It sounds like this: future generations are part of the total concept of humanity as we are and our predecessors before us. We have no right to leave them a planet less worth than the one we have been allowed to live on. Thus ran an argument I remember made an impression on me many, many years ago, and it was written by the internationally best-selling author, Jostein Gaarder. Here he is with a personal message. Please, Jostein.
Your Majesty, kjære konge, dear Mayor of Oslo, and dear host, President of DNB, difference. An important basis for all ethics has been the golden rule, or the principle of reciprocity. You shall do unto others as you would have them do unto you. But the golden rule can no longer just have a horizontal dimension. In other words, we and the others. We must realize that the principle of reciprocity also has a vertical dimension. You shall do to the next generation what you wished the previous generation had done to you. It's as simple as that. You shall love your neighbor as you love yourself. This must obviously include your neighbor generation. It has to include absolute everybody who will live on the earth after us. The human family doesn't inhabit earth simultaneously. People have lived here before us. Some are living now, and some will live after us. But those who come after us are also our fellow human beings. We must do to them as we would have wished that they would have done to us if it was they who had inhabited this planet before us. The code is that simple. We have no right to hand over a planet Earth that is less worth than the planet we ourselves have had the good fortune to live on. Fewer fish in the sea, less drinking water, less food, less rainforest, less coral reefs, fewer species of plants and animals, less beauty, less breathtaking, less splendor and joy. The greatest triumph of philosophy to date may be the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. But how long can we speak of our rights without at the same time focusing on our responsibilities? Perhaps we need a new Universal Declaration. The time is ripe for a Universal Declaration of Human Obligations. The fact is that human activity alters the surroundings and vital necessities on our planet to such an extent that we are now beginning to refer to the period in which we are living as a completely new geological epoch, the Anthropocene. In plants and animals, in the sea and in oil, coal and gas, enormous quantities of carbon are just itching to become oxidized and slip out into the atmosphere. But if all the oil, coal and gas still to be found on this planet is extracted and released into the atmosphere, our civilization will quite simply not survive. Nevertheless, many people consider it their crystal clear right to extract and burn all the oil and all the coal on their own national territory. Why should it not just as well be the crystal clear right of rainforest nations to do what they want with their rainforests? If we are to succeed in saving our own food supply and the biological diversity of this planet, there will need to be a Copernican revolution in our way of thinking. Living as though everything centers around our time is just as naive as it was to believe that all celestial bodies orbit our planet. Our time, however, has no more central importance than all the epochs that will come after us. For us, our time is naturally of the very greatest importance. But we cannot live as though our time is the most important for those who come after us too. It's permissible to hope for a salvation for this world. However, it's not certain that a new heaven and a new earth awaits us. Moreover, it's doubtful whether celestial powers will ever bring about a judgment day. Nevertheless, one day we will be judged by our own descendants. Based on the principle of reciprocity, we should only permit ourselves to use non-renewable resources to the extent that we at the same time pave the way for our descendants to be able to manage without the same resources. Ethical questions are not necessarily so difficult to answer. It's our ability to live by the answers that is often lacking. But if we forget to think about our descendants, they will never forget about us. Man may be the only living creature in the entire universe who has a universal consciousness. I mean a sense of this entire huge and enigmatic universe we are all a part of. So, conserving the living environment of this planet isn't just a global responsibility, it's a cosmic responsibility.